Atheist Nomads episode 149. randomly chatting with other podcasters.
The podcast you're about to listen to includes cursing and talking about hoo-haws. Please be advised.
We are the Atheist Nomads, bringing you history, science, politics, religion, and interviews with leaders in the atheist community. Not all those who wander are lost. Welcome to another episode of Atheist Nomads. I am Dustin. Joining me as always is Wesley.
Hello, everybody.
And joining us for the first part, we have Jesse Dollemore from the I Doubt It with Dollemore Pod. Dollemore podcast.
I appreciate you guys having me on. It's nice to be here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah, man. You seem to have like a pretty interesting setup there. Just talk about random stuff that interests you, and it kind of sounds like what we do, but we usually talk a little bit more shit about religious people.
You guys do.
Yeah.
Yeah. When we first started the show, I had the intent to really kind of have it be atheist based because there's so many shows out there that I really enjoyed. And I kind of let the show just become what it was going to become on its own based on listener feedback or whatever. And we ended up kind of gearing more toward news and comment. And then that's obviously informed by my worldview, which, you know, doesn't involve fairy tales.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Oh, nice. Yeah. And one thing that I do want to point out is we had a guest lined up who flaked on us. Hopefully we'll be getting him on soon. And so Wesley,
I put
20 minutes ago,
call to arms. Yeah.
Yeah. And at this point, we've got three podcasters who have said, yeah, I'll come on.
So fucking A. Thank you so much for speaking up first.
Yeah. Well, hey, yeah. I just got back from Costco and I needed to unwind.
Oh, nice.
Well, awesome.
Liquor in hand, let's enjoy it.
That's, yeah, right. So what's your story?
Well, you know, my story is I'm a former not just theist but crazed, tongue-talking, wild evangelical Christian. And
nice.
Sometime during my service in the Marine Corps, I started shedding the vestiges of Christianity. And I worked on Capitol Hill for the United States Senate for a while after I got out. And it was during that time that I really just dropped the whole fucking facade. F word's good, right?
Yes, yes. This is an adult podcast. You heard the disclaimer.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Cursing and hoo-haws. So we do need to have a reference to hoo-haws at some point.
Just making sure.
Just to make sure we keep my wife happy.
So I'm no longer Christian, obviously. I wouldn't say that I'm a leader in the atheist community, as is stated in your intro, or whatever the specific verbiage was. But, you know, I do believe that living a secular, humanistic life is a better way to live than faith in Jesus, mm-hmm, or Yahweh or Heavenly Father if you're Mormon. And so I would consider myself an evangelical atheist. It's not a term that I coined, obviously,
right?
Evangelical atheist, but it is certainly a term that I like.
Okay. And you know, it is definitely important to make sure that, especially in the podcast field, that we have not only outspoken atheists who do atheist-specific shows, but atheists who are doing general topic shows. Getting that perspective into other areas.
The atheist thing is important. Yeah. Like, hey, you don't need to have a religion or be an atheist to just you. That's not just the only topic out there, you know. Tons of shit to speak about.
Well, you know, we've got listeners who are believers, who are members of the faithful, and I do try to be respectful, and you know, we have a mantra on the show about moving the conversation forward, and that it's not necessarily most important to agree with one another, because an echo chamber does nobody any fucking good. But if we can have a conversation with respect and civility for one another, then that really is the first step in making the world a better place. Recently, we went to a Trump rally here in Costa Mesa, California. And at the rally, we witnessed and ended up getting a hold of to have on the show a gay, Latino, HIV positive Trump supporter.
Oh, wow. You can't
be bullshitting me.
Holy fuck.
If there was ever a unicorn, that's fucking it.
Oh, yeah. Talk about cognitive dissonance for myself, having him sit here in front of me, labeling himself as all these things, and not being able to get my head around it. And I played a bunch of clips of Trump being, you know, fucking Trump, and he would nervously squirm and smile and not really be able to answer any of my questions that were very pointed about what about this? What about, does this make him presidential? Why do you think that this is a respectable position to have? And he, in my estimation, wasn't really able to answer, but we had a respectful conversation, so.
Nice.
That is some weird shit, though, I'll tell you what.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Yeah, we went over there. I had a Zoom recorder, and we got a bunch of interviews with everything from fucking Alex Jones. I saw him on the Alex Jones channel, so we showed up because I love Alex Jones. And that, from that to, you know, your what you would think would be a Trump supporter, which would be sleeveless shirt, you know, white trash tastic kind of guy. So pretty bizarre.
Atheist Nomads is proudly brought to you by Archway Hosting. Check out their low-price, full-featured hosting solutions at archwayhosting.com. That's A-R-C-H-W-A-Y hosting.com.
Hey, we're also brought to you by listeners just like you. Find out how you can become a patron at patreon.com/atheistnomads. That's patreon.com/atheistnomads.
Yeah, sorry, listeners. It got kind of rough there for a little bit, and we had to stop, and we switched what services we were using to try to isolate where the problems were coming.
I blame myself.
I totally forgot where we were at.
I believe there was something about an anal plug.
Oh yeah.
I think that's when the connection got really, really bad, though. So that part might not make it. I think it was more about moving the conversation forward and just the Trump supporter and the white trash and the craziness at the Trump rally.
Okay. And all right, for now that we have more people who have all joined, right,
so you're talking about an orange butt plug on stage.
So we've got five people total on right now. Do we want to just kind of go around basically long introductions and then just have a chat everybody all together, or do each of you want your own time?
I gave everybody the link and said, hey, you know, we're gonna try and kind of schedule this, you know, by segments, but you know, come on and watch, I guess.
Or we can just run with it.
Yeah, I found most great decisions in history have been made by, hey, what the hell, let's see what happens.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so Michael, you are the second one to join. Why don't you tell us a bit about yourself and your show?
Sure. Most folks would recognize me under the name Shujin Tribble. That's a nickname I've been going by for a long time. The show I do is called Holy Crap the Vlogcast. And it really got started because I got together with a couple of guys from Second Life, and we would do a show on Friday nights. You think of it more like a morning zoo at night kind of thing. And there were a couple of times in the news we got stuff that was less than fun to talk about. And unfortunately, it was very religiously based. And we had a bunch of people who were just like, guys, this is not fun to listen to.
Oh, yeah, okay.
So it basically got started a couple of years ago and decided maybe we can turn this into a thing. Maybe it can become a thing of its own. And courtesy of Cash from Atheists on Air, basically kicked our ass, kicked mine specifically. We turned it into a regular show on YouTube, Google Hangouts, and a podcast all of its own.
Nice.
Not bad, not bad. So aside from Second Life, were you raised religious? Where'd you come from? What'd you do kind of thing?
Well, let's see. Part of my old sign-on was I was born in Brooklyn, raised on Long Island, Roman Catholic family. I'm currently outside of Buffalo, New York. I'm an unabashed atheist. I guess you could say that I basically became an I don't care-ist for a number of years. And a couple of years ago, specifically in 2005, we lost my wife. As a matter of fact, it's 11 years this month.
Mm.
That we lost her to a rare form of cancer. And in and amongst dealing with all of that and doing the online DJ thing, a couple of my co-DJs had suggested that I listen to a podcast once in a while, and they had been loving up on George Robb. And okay. Me, I didn't know from squat, and it was like, okay, fine. I'll listen if it'll get you to shut the F up for a change. All right, fine. So it became that. It became Skeptic's Guide. It became a whole bunch of different ones that stuff that I had never learned critical thinking wise. And it was great for me. And that's when I kind of realized, okay, yeah, atheist is really the right term. And it's kind of billowed from there. I always wanted to be a teacher, specifically music, when I was going through high school. And even though I didn't graduate from college, I came away with the love of my life out of it. I still have that teaching thing in me. So I try to use my my platform to help people to think through items, not to get to an answer. But the purpose of my show is just to explore where the question ends and where the answer begins. All of that gray zone, mm-hmm. to try and flesh out how should you think about it, why should you think about it, whatever way, what way had you been thinking about it, and is that really the right way to do it, and kind of come at stuff from an angle that maybe you never thought about before.
Okay, so would you say more of a skeptical podcast then?
Or show? More so, yeah, much more so, but we don't at all shy away from the idea that we collectively think that religion is a detrimental thing to society. Case in point, one of the things that is our part of the typical sign-on is to find out what the current state of affairs is for Rafe Badawi. And mm-hmm. we right now have been running, I've been running specifically a weekly count as to how long he's been incarcerated. And oddly enough, and ironically enough, I think of it more along the lines of the way that the news back in the late 70s, early 80s, actually it was 79, was having a count up for how long the folks at the American embassy in Iran were held hostage. I remember that very clearly from my youth. And it's in a way kind of a callback to that, okay. in an ironic twist.
So a show where you basically go over why bad ideas are bad.
And why good ideas are good, and
awesome.
And how do you go looking at something in the first place? It's not always an easy thing, because there are times when we've had stuff come up where it's like, you know, I as the host have to look back and go, wait a minute, run that by me again, because I don't think I quite understood that. Are you really? Then again, there are some times where I've come up with some ideas that have got people to kind of go, wait a minute. wait a minute, what? I love those moments. I really, really love those moments. Because one of them is kind of become my big nail, shall we say, towards those that want to believe the Bible, specifically the Old Testament, is, you know, is it? Which is to explain that Eve was a downfall of man. Yeah, she was the first skeptic. She was the first scientist. She was the first one to actually question what stuff was. She was the first moralist. She was the first philosopher, according to that book. And she was the one that decided that the better good was to share the knowledge as opposed to obeying some overhead. And people kind of look at me now and they're like, wait a minute. What? Wait, what did you just do? I just turned the entire story up on its head.
Yeah, you know, I was raised Seventh-day Adventist, and they have a added take on, you know, the first real good guy. They don't view it that way, but Satan challenging God is the, you know, why does he get to have all the power? Why does he get to be, you know, the all-knowing? And then, you know, wanted to get at least some say in governance and led a rebellion of the angels to try to get basically a parliament set up. And that was bad, and they were thrown out because of it. And then he taught Eve that, you know, God's not as good of a guy as he says he is.
Funny how that works, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, our last guest over here, I was actually on his show, Inciting Incident, just recently. We got Alex Goodlive up. Hey, man, how you doing?
Doing pretty well. Thanks for having me on. I go under the name Al Laiman on the show, but, you know, I don't really hide my identity too much.
If you'd like, I could edit that out.
That's fine. It really doesn't matter too much.
Okay.
Both websites lead to the same site.
Oh, man.
So tell us a bit about your show.
Well, my show started as a film, like, podcast kind of thing, because at my school they were starting this new website for film, and one of my majors is cinema. But after four or five episodes, we started getting a lot of questions about our philosophy, our politics, and of course our interest in skeptic podcasters, present company included. And we started just bullshitting about serious issues and social commentary, things like that, and that took off a lot quicker than the film podcast did. But because we love movies and we love analyzing movies, we decided to do both. So Friday night is more of our serious social commentary, political, that kind of thing. And then Sunday, we just bullshit about movies. And then we had Wes on the show, and it was an interview for about 4 minutes, and then we just bullshit about movies the rest of the time.
Nice. Yeah,
I loved geeking out about fucking every movie I've ever loved. And like three really shitty ones.
Oh, there's nothing more entertaining than a really, really terrible movie. I've gone to The Room in theaters at least 7 times.
Oh, no.
No? Yeah. I've gone to live showings that has participation like Rocky Horror Picture Show. It's great.
I've watched Batman versus Superman 3 times. That's probably about the same.
A little bit more money behind it, but otherwise about the same quality, yeah.
Truly horrible.
All right. And Al, what's your story?
Oh, I like to say that I failed at a lot of things by the time I was 25, but I got really interesting stories about it. It was out of high school at 15, lived in 6 or 7 different states, just kind of wandering, doing, you know, minimum wage retail stuff. Got married young, was divorced young, had kids young, and then I decided, you know what I should do? I should be a pro wrestler.
Yeah.
So I did. And I was a pro wrestler in the Pittsburgh, Ohio, West Virginia area while selling shoes as a day job, and I did that for about 2 years. Then I got a job offer to come out to Minneapolis and work at Nordstrom Shoes, where the average commission paycheck per week was about $2,000-$3,000.
Yeah.
And I moved out there from where I live, Pennsylvania. They didn't bother to tell me it was seasonal.
Oh.
So I moved out there for 2 months and was suddenly without a job. Made enough money to hold out for about 8 months, and I moved back and I said, I can never let this happen to me again. You know, I'm 25, I'm almost 26. I really got to figure things out. Went back to community college and excelled to the point that I got into an Ivy League school, transferred there in 2013, and ever since then, you know, written films, written columns, won a couple awards, won a couple film festivals, and started this show, which has took off a lot quicker than anything else I've ever done. Tried YouTube for a while, and that didn't do much.
Sorry, man, but you have a face for radio.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I've been playing basketball all day, so.
Films that you've worked on that people might recognize?
Probably not. There's one coming out this summer called Equity. It has Janine Garofalo, Anna Gunn, and Alicia Reiner. And it's called, you know, like I said, it's called Equity. It's like the female version of Wall Street. And I was a featured extra in that. I got promoted on set. And about 20 or 30 minutes into the movie, there's a slow pan across a courtyard, like outside of a courthouse, and you will be able to see me in full view playing an evil attorney.
Nice. Yeah, I'm guessing you're down in Southern California now.
I'm still near Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. I still had about 5 classes to do at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. That's another crazy part of the story. I commute 100 miles each way every day.
Holy shit. During the school
year on top of that. So once I'm done with school and I have the degrees, then I'll probably be out in SoCal or somewhere else where there's film productions going on. A lot of cities are popping up in the Midwest that are doing that kind of thing. Pittsburgh, Cleveland, Minneapolis, Chicago. I'll end up somewhere working on something, I imagine.
Okay, so Pittsburgh, you consider Pittsburgh to be Midwest?
Kind of, just because I'm originally from the Cleveland area, and it's so close that we just consider ourselves sort of twin cities. There's a big rivalry between Cleveland and Pittsburgh, but I think it's because we're both redheaded stepchildren that the rest of the country hates, so I just kind of group them in together.
I did a year at the Seventh Adventist Theological Seminary in Berrien Springs, Michigan. So just across Lake Michigan from Chicago, and mm-hmm. people were calling it the Midwest. And I was like, how the hell is this the Midwest? It's midway to the West. I grew up in Southern Oregon. I was literally, like, as the crow flies, 60 miles from the Pacific Ocean.
Oh, wow.
And you could drive from southwestern Michigan to the Atlantic Ocean in one day. It takes 3 days to get there. Long days to get there from where I grew up. It's like, how the hell is this Midwest? Montana,
beautiful country.
Yeah. Come on. It might be the Puget Sound, but if I just look through a couple of trees right here, I'm actually seeing the Pacific Ocean.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
And I'm in Pennsylvania, so I'm just seeing hemp and regret.
And the hemp's not even legal.
Nope. Yeah. There's a lot of holdover hippies around here, so it's here.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's get back to Jesse here. I don't know if you're on mute.
No, I'm good.
Oh, okay.
I wouldn't have blamed you if you muted me out. It's all good.
Yeah, that's coming. Don't worry. And click.
We love hearing from our listeners. You can email us at contact@atheistnomads.com, tweet us @atheistnomads, send us a message on our Facebook page at facebook.com/atheistnomads, or better yet, call us and leave us a message at 541-203-0666. We might even play it on the show. You can also help us out by leaving us a review on iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcast directory of choice.
All right. So, man, what drives you in the morning? Like, what gets you up? What's your passions?
Well, you know, I just started kind of a YouTube venture where I'm trying to meld the show and YouTube together, and I've done a couple videos, and the magic number with YouTube is 10,000 subscribers, and at that point you can use YouTube Studios in Los Angeles, and I'm at like 7,800 subscribers, so I'm fucking right on the cusp of being able to go up there and use their equipment and their studios and stuff. So I'm starting to take that a little bit more seriously. And that will, in turn, fuel, again, you furthering the conversation.
Yeah, that'll definitely
talking about the issues that are very important to us right now. Back to kind of the politics and the presidential election that we currently face. You know, every presidential election, they say, this is the most important election of all time. And usually I think it's fucking bullshit. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not the most important, but this one, maybe it's just my paranoia or my panic, but I think this one might be the most important election of our America, because I lean conservative, although I'm an atheist. I know that everybody just cringed and squirmed in their seats, but I have some conservative leanings, but I've never voted for a Democrat, and I am full on gonna vote for Hillary Clinton, and I'm probably gonna vote for Bernie Sanders a week from today in the California primary. So yeah. Well,
you still have some respect for me for going Bernie.
Well, listen, man. For me, it's not just a protest vote to vote for Bernie. I don't agree with a ton of stuff that his campaign is based on. However, or I don't agree with the manner with which he's going to achieve those things. However, he is a noble, upright, upstanding, honest, true American. He really, really has a love for this country, where a guy like, well, we'll just go the other way, someone like Hillary Clinton, I don't feel the passion for bettering our situation as a country from her. I feel she's in it for her. How can I benefit myself? And that might be cynical, but, and obviously that's clearly the case with Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. But Bernie Sanders is a fucking noble man.
You know, I just heard this, read this article earlier today saying that Trump's campaign is basically fucking out of money. And yeah, they're begging the RNC or high-end Republicans for money now. So that just gave me a hell of a chuckle, because he was always supposed to be self-funded.
Well, that's the entire thing. That the entire, since last July and June, he's talked about, oh, I'm self-funding, which has been a total fabrication. He's not self-funding. He is loaning himself the money. He's loaning the campaign the money, and then hoping, oh, I'm going to get the nomination, and then the RNC will pay back the loans that Trump made to his campaign as a general election campaign. So he's, listen, it's not a surprise to anybody. He's a fucking liar.
Well, that and the media, they've been giving him so much free media just because they're like, let's see what this crazy fuck will say.
Yeah.
And man, I still kind of blame part of this on the media in general, giving him so much time.
Trump is great at sound bites that make perfect headlines that will get clicks. Well, he's clickbaited the election.
One analyst has estimated that he's gotten 2 billion with a B, bravo, $2 billion worth of free media coverage. And I blame CNN. I blame MSNBC. I blame the Fox News, obviously. Fox, I can say that. I blame them because, you know, he has a campaign rally and all he's doing is spewing hate and incitement to violence. And they give him fucking 35, 45 minutes of free airtime. Goddamn, that's it's certainly unethical. Because it's a quest for ratings and it's a quest for advertising dollars. But I think it's immoral. I think it's immoral as well.
It is. The big problem of it is, of course, as we know the old expression, if it bleeds, it leads. And if it's spewing out of his mouth, it's bleeding all over everything. And what are they going to do? They're going to turn away an opportunity for people to have eyes on their product so that advertisers know that they're getting eyes on the product? Mm-hmm. It's all comes down to, unfortunately.
It also saddens me because, you know, 3 years ago, if you had asked me, I mean, maybe I'm naive, but I would have said, you know, racism isn't as big a problem as people like to say. It's sure there's some racist elements in our nation, but now, holy fuck, there's no way to deny that he has spoken to, he has awakened a sleeping giant, mm-hmm. which He's is normalized. millions of quote-unquote disaffected voters in the United States who are at their core, at their base, hateful, racist fucking bigots. And that makes me sad. I mean, and I don't say that hyperbolically. It makes me fucking sad. It really does.
No, that asshole has normalized racism, and he's turned back the clock.
Yeah.
I knew racism and sexism never went away, but I didn't. Holy shit, yeah, it's definitely opened my white eyes to, like, mm-hmm. just how fucking bad it is.
Yeah.
No,
it's just a matter of bringing it out, it's validating it. And it's validating it in the way of vindication through the illusion of PC, which is something I talked about a lot on my show, which is he's spoken to a lot of people who have a false victim persecution complex and said, hey, everything was awesome before X came along, so you're the good people. You're the moral people. And it's not that racism, sexism, homophobia, transphobia are bad. It's just the PC keeping people from telling you the truth and from allowing you to be right. So if we just got rid of that, everything would be awesome.
Yeah.
You pretty much described it. Pretty much every religious person out there.
If I could, there was a TV show that I used to watch, loved, back in the 70s, called Match Game. Now, those of us that are a little bit older remember this fondly. It was fun as all hell. And for anybody that doesn't have quite the grasp of, okay, how bad could it be?
If you
go back to Match Game, which was the mid-70s, you will see the self-depreciating humor that was with all of them. It didn't matter if you were white, black, flaming homosexual, which one of them was, or if you were there just because you just wanted the paycheck sometimes, which kind of came off. But it was at least accepted that everybody looked at each other and said, hey, let's have fun at ourselves at this point because we can. As opposed to now where everybody is against everybody else, or so it would seem if you're to listen to all of the crap that's being spewed all over the place. It really was a much different time. Admittedly, it was, 10, 15 years after the civil rights big, the bus through the South that was firebombed and all, but at least we had an opportunity to say, you know what, we can try to have a little bit of humor to diffuse everything just by being us and being funny.
Mm-hmm. From what I remember of the Match Game, I mean, it was all these stars that were like on the way downhill of their trajectory, right. And they were saying the things that people were saying about them anyways, and having a laugh about it, and I did love that.
As a related aside, Alec Baldwin just signed a deal, and they're redoing the Match Game with Alec Baldwin as the host.
Oh, God, it'd be perfect.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty fun. Wow.
Tell me they're just giving him a mic and letting him say whatever he wants. I'll watch the shit out of that.
But on the racism part, Lauren, one of her recent jobs, and of course this was before Trump started his candidacy, she was surrounded by coworkers here in Boise, Idaho, that they weren't, quote, racist. They just wanted to keep people separate. And
right.
Separationists was the term they used to describe themselves. They just wanted the races to all be separate.
They actually used the term separationist for themselves?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah, separate but equal was... Lauren is across the room from me, and yeah. Separate but equal is what they wanted. They would get offended when someone would come in with an accent and wouldn't want to help them. Would just start passing the person around to other... people on the sales floor. And so Lauren ended up helping when she was working there almost everyone who came in who didn't have the best English, because it made these people angry that someone wouldn't speak perfect English in their city.
Let me tell you, I'll make an admission here. I guess this is going to turn into a fucking counseling session. But
tell me about your mother.
I also Well, not also, but I grew up in northern Idaho, where Dustin is now, and in Boise more recently. Although I live in Los Angeles now, I want to say that, like, now, I'm one of the good ones.
One thing I need to specify, northern Idaho compared to Boise might as well be part of eastern Washington or Montana. Oh, it's yeah, closer to both so than it is Boise.
You were up in the neck of Idaho that my mom and us always drove through really quickly.
Yeah, that's right. So I grew up, though, and I admit this, I've talked about this on my show, that I used to be a guy, if I heard people speaking a foreign language, I'd be like, fucking speak American, speak English. And I've had to, I mean, that's years and decades ago, when I was still, you know, a member of the Christian faith. But it is a weird, I've had to analyze and feel really bad about that, because what the fuck does it matter to me or those people with whom your wife works? What does it matter to them if they speak another fucking language or have an accent?
Yeah.
This is America, goddammit. We begged for people to come over to build our bridges, to build our railroads, to build the infrastructure that became the mightiest nation on the planet. Fuck you if they speak with an accent.
Mm-hmm.
And fuck me. Fuck the old me who used to think that too.
Yeah.
Fuck all those people because all these immigrant people that are coming here are speaking two languages plus all this other shit. I mean,
yes,
they're putting in tons of fucking work.
Now, the one exception I can make on it is when technology and the accent are making it so you can't understand the person. I end up dealing with a electronic medical record vendor based out of India quite a bit. And when I have to talk to them on the phone, they're hopping that through Massachusetts. And so you've got people in India who speak relatively good English. I mean, actually, most of them speak very good English. But by the time you hop it from India to Massachusetts, and then it gets hopped over to Spokane, and then they transfer that call down to Boise, it is so degraded. That unless you had no accent, like a British person would be impossible to understand.
Yeah.
Well, they are impossible.
But that's not sitting in a restaurant and and hearing the Mexican folks next to you and being like, God damn them. Fuck, come on.
Mm-hmm.
We're all fucking humans spinning around on this blue marble. Calm down.
Yeah.
Calm the fuck down.
Oh, man.
I'm getting fired up. I'm sorry.
Oh, no. Jingoism is like the worst thing ever. I mean, that is the stupidest thing. I'm American. Yeah. Who gives a fuck? I'm like, we're human.
Yeah. Okay.
Calm the fuck down.
We're fortunate our ancestors immigrated here.
Yeah.
We're all white. We're all descended from immigrants.
You have no say in where you're born, what your name is, any of that shit. Fuck. Just take the fucking flags off the back of your fucking hopped up truck and get over yourself.
Well, that's the other thing, is that odd bastardization of what their view of America is. I saw someone with whom I went to high school with today on Facebook, and they posted this fucking meme, which is how we communicate now. And it was on the top. It was, if they want to fly their flag, and it was the rainbow flag. Why can't we fly ours? And it's the Confederate flag, which, I can't even really fucking go right. Are you goddamn? Are you kidding me? One is the flag of a traitorous fucking influence that tried to break away from this nation, and one is a symbol of rights and pride. And anyway, fuck. But I wanted to say, and I didn't because, you know, what's the use sometimes? Really, my northern Idaho high school guy, really? This is your flag, the Confederate flag? You know, the farthest possible place other than where you're sitting right now, Wesley, to be from the South. Fuck off. That's not your flag.
Yeah, and you'll see it all over rural Idaho. You will see the Confederate flag. But there's actually a historical reason for that. After the Civil War, Idaho was a major spot for Southerners to migrate
to tuck their tail and run to.
Yeah. And Okay, then you add to it. When I was a little kid, I lived in Malheur County in Eastern Oregon. Spent my first 8 years there. I had a distinctive accent.
I think you mean Bundy County.
No, sure. that was the Malheur National Wildlife Refuge, which is in neighboring Harney County.
Oh, it's in Harney County. Sorry.
Yeah, that's related to the Malheur River, not Malheur County. Yeah. Anyway, there's actually a distinctive accent in Malheur County, distinct from anywhere else in the country. Most people don't recognize it, but there's little bits of Texas. There's little bits of the South. There's just some random hick drawl thrown in and a little bit of Basque influence. And it's enough melding right there that you just sound like a ignorant hick.
Well, the fleeing Southerners coupled with the Mormons who would soon or maybe possibly have been there right now. I don't know the exact the technical history of the Mormon church, but there was also that racial element mm-hmm. in Southern Idaho at that time too.
Oh yeah.
This is so bizarre hearing this because I haven't heard anything about Iowa since my ex-girlfriend left. She was from Boise and born and raised there and only moved out here a couple of years before she and I started dating. So this is really bizarre because I swear I've heard almost all these stories before.
Hey, did you say Iowa?
Idaho. Did I say Iowa? I meant Idaho. Sorry.
One yeah. has corn, the other has potatoes.
Common mistake.
Yeah.
Now all this shit is just getting reconfirmed for you. So yeah, a secondary source. Yeah, it's real.
Yep.
Oh yeah.
She wasn't fucking with you.
Well, she was, but just not on that.
Well, and when you're in Boise and you're like for me and the I work in the medical industry. I deal with I spend most of my social contacts is with the atheist community here. I'm the executive director of the Treasure Valley Coalition of Reason. So, you know, I see the best of the community. And it's horrifying to have those reminders that, oh, yeah, I'm surrounded by batshit crazy religious people and bigots.
And, yeah, white supremacists just all over there. Yeah, I don't know. It was that's like a little neck of the country that, you know, my mom told me to roll their windows up and just drive through past the fucking Lake Coeur d'Alene because that's where all the white supremacist people are at.
They were at Hayden were Lake.
There, yeah.
And that always kind of scared me. And I was like, you know, these are supposed to be nice people. And I don't understand this because I was like a little young kid and it just.
Well, what's great is if you drive through Coeur d'Alene now, there are signs on all the businesses on their storefronts that say we are inclusive and we fucking love everybody and Rainbow Coalition. They really want to get the message out that look, that shit does not, it's not emblematic of who we are. Mm-hmm. In fact, Kootenai County, which is where Coeur d'Alene is on a scale of Idaho, pretty progressive for Idaho.
Nice. Well, until a bunch of Californians moved up and took over.
Well, because they wanted to, it's all the Californians like Mark Furman. Mm-hmm. The O.J. Simpson guy is like, I got to get the fuck out of California. And then he goes up there and changes the makeup.
Yep. they took, it was crazy. Californians, you know, one of the bluest states out there, moved to northern Idaho and took one of the bluest parts of the country and turned it bright red.
Yeah, it's fucking weird. That's an awesome way to put it. That's exactly what happened. Goddamn.
If you like this show, consider giving us some financial support. To make it really easy with one-time donations or to support us on a per-episode, monthly, or even annual basis using PayPal or Patreon, find out more at atheistnomads.com. Use the links on the right side of the page. $1 an episode is all we ask. Please, think of the kittens.
All right, so we got a post on our Facebook page today from Questioning Atheism was the page that posted this.
I swear they're just trolls.
To sum up their argument, and this was probably about 300 words total, how can you have creation without a creator?
Oh, Jesus.
Checkmate atheists.
They have a page. They have 17 likes, and they have, like, 20 memes, and they're all just really bad.
Ooh, can I cut this one? Can
take
I,
it. Yeah, take it. It. Run with it.
Prove to me that there is creation involved, and then I'll go after the rest of it. Thank you very much. Nice and simple. God, I just, what insipidness.
I just posted a new video on YouTube that is proof, it's with a question mark at the end of it, but proof the Christian God does not exist. And it's if morality is based on God and God is not moral, then what? Where are we left? Fuck mm-hmm. you. There's not. Come on. Goddamn. It's an 11-minute video that really could have been done with just what I just said. But yeah. You know, that doesn't get me any any traction. But Michael, it's Michael, right?
You call me that. Like I said, typically I go by Shujin.
Shujin. Shujin's right. He's exactly right. It's
thank you. All right, that's it. And credits. There we go. Close the show.
Outro play.
Yeah. You know, we can all imagine what a created universe would look like. There would be signatures
life everywhere.
There would be some kind of something there. It's not.
Yeah.
I covered this on the intro of one of my shows, 5 minute freestyle is what I call it, instead of a diatribe or anything like that. If it were up to me, a created universe would be like Minecraft. Every piece is its own piece. A fish is fish. Human is human. A tree is whatever that type of wood is, and that is it. There's nothing smaller than that. But it's been crafted smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller that we've been able to identify further and further and further and further and further, further down.
Mm-hmm.
And my whole thing of it was, look, why should there be all this extra complexity in the mix? It's not making any kind of sense. You start off with these things that are smaller and smaller and smaller until you get to these things that we can't quite figure out. Are they actual particles? Are they mm-hmm. vibrating strings? Are they strings that exist in outside of the four dimensions that we know of now? What the frick is going on? And I'm sorry, am I allowed to say fuck?
Yes. I don't know
what to say. Yes. Okay. The frick is going on? So how can you go ahead and say that this is creation when the universe is far and away more complex than you can even give your God credit for? Please. Well,
first, I have to say, fuck a mustard seed. It's not the smallest. Second, why do we share so much information between all of our genetics, between one species and another? I mean,
one of the best I got on that was from the Evolution 101 podcast that Zachary Moore did. This is 6, 7, 8 years back. There, you take a look at the mitochondrial DNA, and it is the rate of mutation that you see fits with what is predicted by the evolutionary model. Despite the fact that you could take a mitochondria from a yeast and replace a human cell's mitochondria with that, or all of the human cells in a human body, they'd be just fine. You could take a mitochondria for a human, put it in a yeast, and it would be just fine. They are functionally identical, but the rate of mutation
fits awesome.
Exactly. That's if it was created, you would expect the rate of mutation to be identical across every single species. Not that our mitochondria be closest to chimpanzees and furthest from yeast.
Yeah, now this point,
a lot of them also don't acknowledge that the universe is as big as, you know, those evil conspiratorial scientists say. I mean, oh God, it gets to me every time. But in their defense, I'm not saying I agree with this, but I am saying I get it. When you've been raised your whole life to say that pretty much the universe revolves around you, your God, your people, and your family, and then you realize, or at least are told, how big the universe or even just the galaxy actually is, that is a terrifying thought when you are not raised with it. And being confronted with that is something that's really scary from their perspective, I think. Is that fair?
It's absolutely fair, but it's also the science illiteracy, or the mm-hmm. rate with which people are not science literate in this country. Everybody should be, I don't know, but I hate saying things like this, should be required to fucking have a duh. But everybody should take an intro to astronomy class just to learn about where iron comes from. And it's because it's the compression, and then it's fusion, forcing, or how we know how far away certain things because of blue shift or red shift. Goddamn, it's crazy complex and awesome the way we know the things we know through physics and science. And it's because people are very happy where they are in their comfortable lives, believing in Jesus, and let's lay hands on him.
Mm-hmm.
He's sick. Oh, let's lay hands on him, rather than just appreciating the wealth of knowledge that we have through science and research and fucking data.
I've always kind of wondered if there is a correlation between the flat earthers and really fundamentalist religious people. People that just deny science so much.
Well, I don't know. I've, and again, it's maybe because I doubt that people are really that dumb, like that one rapper guy who was doing his thing about the flat earth thing. But like my little brother, whom I love, he's my little brother, it kind of goes unsaid, but he is wildly intelligent, and it's going to sound fucking dumb to say this, but he's a young earth creationist. And he very much reveres Matt Slick, Dustin, who's right there with you mm-hmm. in Boise.
His daughter a long time ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a sector of, Rachel's her name, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a sector or a segment of Christianity that got so deep into apologetics that they become, they're the neckbeard Christians, if you know what I mean. And my little brother, I guess, would be one of them. And it's, mm-hmm. he's a smart guy. No one could say he's a dumb guy. He's super successful. He's a fucking smart guy, goddammit. He is. But he believes some obscenely stupid fucking things.
I forget who coined it. Wouldn't that be called a smart, stupid person? Or a stupid, smart person? Something like that?
That would be the better way to say it, but I like using like 500 words to describe things rather Fair than enough. Like 10.
We always went for educated idiots.
Yeah, that's it.
See, the funny part of it is, I don't like to go down that route, because whenever I look at it, and it's fun to joke about, don't get me wrong,
sure.
But to me, I've had an expression that I've been using for situations like this, which is very simple. You were taught wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Whenever I've used that, it takes the onus off of people to say, we don't have to say, look, you're stupid, you're dumb, you're an idiot. No, 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 no. You were taught something that was factually incorrect, and you are still holding on to what you were taught. Okay, no problem, no worries. Let me show you why. That's yeah. one of the things that I feel is one of the cornerstones for me, for the way that I've been trying to get people to understand, look, I can show you where it's wrong. I can show you where a left turn at Albuquerque wasn't the right way to go. I can explain these things for you. Give me a chance. Because this also takes off. They're not stupid. They're not dumb. They were taught the wrong way by somebody who probably themselves was taught wrong, and it just simply goes back far enough. And, you know, as people who are skeptical, who love the fuck out of shit, I said science, I'm sorry. I think that we could actually go ahead and admit, look, we've gotten things wrong before, and we found out that we were wrong, and we changed it, and we fixed it, and now we don't do that no more. Let me show you how that works.
Now, the one problem with that approach is you take a conservative Christian who believes in a literal 7-day creation, for example. That is someone for whom what they were taught was reinforced by the inerrant word of God, and their immortal soul is at risk and tied to that. So anything you say is coming from the devil. I remember as a child praying for Bill Nye.
Yeah.
I loved science, but I thought they were wrong.
The only way that I can think of dealing for something like that would be, okay, then show me how you're right. Show me that I'm wrong. And if somebody is willing to go ahead and take the step into the, I don't want to call it the ring, into whatever, to try to talk, that's already half the battle. Don't do the whole thing. I know. I'm a child of the 80s too. Don't do that thing. But even just coming to that semblance of civility is in and of itself something that you need to treasure very, very, very carefully in that moment and not kick somebody. Even if you come out wrong when all is said and done, at least having somebody say, look, maybe this guy wasn't such an asshole. Maybe I can have this talk again later. That, to me, is something that at least brings hope that a continued communication can bring something out of it. You may not necessarily win every battle, but at least you can have the conversation, and that level of civility can grow into something worthwhile.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you were talking about earlier, basically being able to take the wrongness off of their shoulders, like, you know, you were just taught wrong, is a very, and not just saying you are wrong, is a excellent way to get a conversation started. And, you know, I would be happy to give that a try.
It externalizes the negative. It's not you that's wrong. It's the teaching.
It's some fucker over there. Yeah.
Yeah, and there's plenty of times where in my lifetime, I was born in March of 1969, so I'm 39 years old now. There's a long story about that. 39 years old. And I remember as a kid, my parents had the old-time life books on science and space, and I remember looking very clearly at the planets that were listed, and yes, Pluto was at that time still listed as a planet, but I remember very vividly all of the different things about how big is it, what's the atmosphere composition, what's the mass of it, are there any moons, question marks, just a series of question marks, didn't know, no idea, no clue whatsoever. And what's happened this past year, we had the fastest fucking spacecraft that we've ever launched, and inside of a decade or whatever the hell, however fast it went out there, screaming fast, we've now got information about this sucker that there's no way in hell we could have known before. We could have postulated by getting some really good Kodachrome images of it from here, but still, we know far and away more than we ever could have at the time. We've added to
it.
And we've changed what we thought.
From a really quick flyby at that.
Yeah.
That's basically a snapshot. Amazing.
Yeah.
An amazing up-close snapshot, and it's just awesome.
Yeah, and oddly enough, this is one of those situations where I'm both gratified and terrified of that probe all at the same time. I am so incredibly grateful for it, for having flown through, gotten all the pictures that it did, getting all the data, firing it back to us at a modem's pace. Kids, look up what a modem was. And what I'm terrified of is that suddenly it's going to go dark because it impacted something that we never knew was there. Which in and of itself is both frighteningly terrifying and how fucking cool. We hit something hard out there. We need to go back and find out what it is.
I'm optimistic that it will continue its voyage towards Vulcan or Kronos.
I really hope not. I don't want to think that a piece of NASA suddenly becomes, you know, pull! No. I don't know. Kids, look up that reference, too. It was a bad movie.
Come on, we need V'ger.
No. If V'ger was the Silver Surfer equivalent of the Borg, no, we don't. No. Yes, I'm a kid at heart. Shut up.
I'm completely lost. I have no idea what you guys are
talking about. Okay.
You didn't get the Star Trek reference?
Okay, first the universe cooled, and then the Earth cooled, and then the dinosaurs came. They got too big and fat. They died. They turned into oil, and then... Wait, how far back did you miss?
Yeah. Maybe sum up. Silver Surfer. I'll just drink more of my drink.
Just drink more.
We kind of bounced across a couple of universes. The real one, the Star Trek one, some of the comic book ones. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
What's everybody drinking?
Squirt. All of them in my mouth.
Squirt all up in my mouth. I'm drinking ginger and whiskey all up in my mouth.
Ginger ale?
Mm. Yeah. Okay. Jim Beam and ginger ale. And okay. Ice. Mm. All up in my mouth.
You know, kind of like whenever you open up a fortune cookie, should always be in bed. We should start a new thing, all up in my mouth.
I fucking like it a lot.
Oh, I've got Black Butte Porter.
All right.
It's nice having Lauren working again so I can actually drink good beer again.
Yay. I was in an Asian grocery store today, and I know this is not relevant, but I saw a fucking a rogue beer that was sriracha.
Mm-hmm.
What in the fuck is that? That seems like blasphemy to me.
I have known fucking weird. People who've drank it. I have not bothered.
Yeah, that was my take too.
Sriracha beer?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If it's flavored, it either better be an IPA, a shandy, or a stout.
It's that rogue,
flavor
so
my beer overly.
It's probably a IPA.
I don't know. It was too weird to even. I just ran away.
Yeah, their most famous beer would be Angry Bastard, which is
Arrogant Bastard.
Or Arrogant Bastard, which is like almost 10% alcohol and like three times the hoppiness of a standard IPA.
Yeah, it's bitter as fuck. It's nasty.
I was at a bar in Minneapolis, a German bar, and they had a beer that I believe was 19.4%.
Oh.
It's called Avery Mephistopheles.
Wow.
Drink it.
In other words, the devil, is it not?
That's how the bartender can tell if you've had enough. If you can still pronounce it, you're okay. See, and me, I don't like beer. I have a specific wine that my wife and I loved. That's about the only thing that I'll drink, except every once in a while, I will be an absolute fuck. And if I'm out to a bar, I will actually go up and ask the bartender for a grasshopper. Partly because I love the opportunity of watching the bartender go, wait, no, I remember this. I remember how to do this.
I had to make this on the first day.
Yep, that's it. And then I get to take it back to the table, and people look at it and they go, what the hell is that? It is green.
So what's in a grasshopper?
A creme de menthe.
Cream de cocoa, milk, ice, shake, and it is a delicious piece of mint taste. I love it simply because of that. I love mint.
Huh.
It would be like drinking an alcoholic thin mint to me.
Yeah.
Lauren, bleh. Do you like mint flavor?
There's a wonderful little craft whiskey and vodka place up here, and they make this amazing, just perfect coffee flavored vodka. I just add half and half to that, put it over ice, and call it my fake white Russians in there. Pretty tasty.
White Alaskans?
Sure. I'll go with that. Everybody got quiet. Anyways. I like it. I don't see I'm not wearing pants. All
right. And Al, we didn't get what you're drinking. If you are
drinking anything. I'm not drinking anything. I got to drive later.
Oh, okay. Bummer.
But when I do, I'll have my own version of the alcoholic thin mint and just do straight Dr. McGillicuddy's menthol mint.
What? This is not a thing I've heard of.
Dr. McGillicuddy's, it's different flavors of schnapps. I believe they have like apple pie, root beer, cherry. But my favorite, because I also love mint, is they do mint peppermint schnapps, but it's menthol, so it's got a much stronger kick to it. And it's my dig. I buy one once a week, and there we go.
Hmm. All right. Nice.
All up in your mouth.
Oh, man.
Sounds like my high school days. A little juice bottle filled with the Kuipers in there.
All right, gentlemen, we are out of time.
This has been fun. Let's have you guys go through one by one and plug your shit. Shows, Twitters, Facebooks, whatever you like. All right, well, start with Alex.
All right. Our show is Inciting Incident. It's on blogtalkradio.com/incitingincident, and you can catch Wes here in a previous episode. And we, like I said, we just bullshit about movies for most of the show, but it's still fun. We air on Fridays and Sundays at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, facebook.com/incitingincidentpodcast and incitingincidentpodcast.com. I can also, for any wrestling fans out there, I'm also Al Laiman on lordsofpain.net, and I can be reached at allaiman.com because I write a column there that for some reason people give a shit about, which is pretty much anything I've done, for some reason, people like it. So,
And are you still wrestling?
No. Concussions will do that to you. But I did write a book about it, and now I just write about it because I don't get concussions writing about it most of the time.
Nice.
Awesome. Shujin, tell us about you.
First off, smart of you to actually stop with the concussions. That's actually a good sign that you're recovering. Good man.
Yeah, getting hit in the face a bunch of times by someone who wants to show how tough they are in a constructed pretend fight. Kind of wanted to get out of that after that became a thing.
Wait, wrestling's pretend?
Some of it. Only some of it.
And not only the... some of the time, trust me, I got the shit beaten out of me by three people who thought they had something to prove, and they were all bigger than me, and I got punched full on with a forearm in the face. I had 200-pound people dropping on my head. Like, I've watched the video. I don't remember this match.
Oh, wow.
But it's just three people beating the ever-loving hell out of me, and I could not do a thing because the first shot they took at my head just knocked me out. And it was one of those things where, like, the bad guy group was taking over the arena, and, you know, one of them was the referee. And when your own supposed quote-unquote biggest rival who's supposed to be taunting you is down going, Al, you need to let him out. I think he's hurt. Like, you can actually see that on camera. That's how bad it is.
Oh, wow.
Congratulations on your change of employment. Good man. Anyway, I am known, like I said earlier, I'm known as Shujin Tribble pretty much all over the place. It's really hard to miss me if you can Google even half of that. And yes, Tribble as in Star Trek Tribbles. If you don't get that much, I can't really much help you. The show is Holy Crap the Vlogcast. You can find that over on YouTube, Facebook. You can find all the links that you need for that off of holycrapthevlogcast.com. If you try a little bit hard, you should be able to Google that without too much of trouble. We record live to stream Sunday mornings. I have to make sure that I say this correctly. Sunday mornings, Eastern Time, 12:05 a.m. The whole point was to actually have one of those shows that's kind of like counterculture to the coast-to-coast a.m. bullshit. Yeah, part of the reason for that. You can find the Twitter account, of course, for the show over there. If you'd like to find me for the stuff that I do, which is partly skepticism, partly the furry culture, brony culture, yes, I'm one of those guys, you can find me at Shujin Tribble on Twitter. And if you don't mind, a small sideline plug. This past weekend, which was the weekend of the 27th, I completed a 36-plus hour online DJ stream to raise money for the Ride for Roswell to benefit the Roswell Park Cancer Institute, which was the group that was working on my wife. So if anybody would like to support that in any way, the hashtag that I was using for the weekend was R4R36HR, for Ride for Roswell 36 Hour. And if you want to check out the page, maybe contribute, maybe join as a virtual rider, it's roswellpark.org. Yes, I know, it sounds like it should be in New Mexico. It's not. Roswellpark.org. The name of the team, the fundraising team, is End of Cycle for Sarcoma. And any and all support in any way, even if it's just a message of congratulations or just an attaboy, is appreciated. It doesn't have to be dollars. Dollars are great, but it's one of the few times a year where I actually say, yes, I want money, because it's going to them, the guys that are helping me to get my little bit of revenge on this disease.
All right, and link to that and everything else will be in the show notes. Oh, go ahead.
I just want to say my co-host is a brony, so we should definitely get you on our show sometime so you two can talk about that.
Oh, that's going to go over just great. And I'm sorry, what was it that you were just asking me?
Oh, links to that and all the shows, of course, will all be in the show notes.
Thank you.
Cancer sucks, and it needs to be destroyed.
Yeah, I believe it was XKCD that coined the term fuck cancer.
Yeah.
And even though the guys officially over at RPCI probably squirm a little bit at seeing that, you can find that hashtag a lot for me during this time of year.
Very nice. And Jesse.
Well, again, my name is Jesse Dollemore, and I am half of the podcast I Doubt It with Dollemore. We're a news and comment show twice weekly. We release on Mondays and Thursdays. We can be found on iTunes and Google Play, Stitcher, although they make money off me and I don't make anything. anywhere you can get a podcast, you could find us. Just search I Doubt It or Dollemore, which is Dollemore. And we are committed to moving the conversation forward. And also, I guess, since I've talked about YouTube a little bit, YouTube is just Dollemore on the YouTubes.
Very nice. Sweet. All right, that's it for this episode. You'll be able to find the show notes with all the links at atheistnomads.com/149. And next week we'll be back with episode 150.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Hey, thanks.
Yeah, agreed. I forget what we're up to, 120, 130. You know what? I've completely forgotten off the top of my head.
32.
Yeah, no. when we hit 100 through 104, that was kind of special for me. 104 was effectively one episode a week for 2 years. So I got a bunch of others that were all kind of inspired and kicked in the ass by Cash, and we had a good time talking about his ass, and he didn't show up, motherfucker. But it's great to be with you guys. I'm deeply honored. I know it was kind of we got to see who we can get, but thank you for letting me come on with you guys. I really do appreciate it. No, it's nice to feel like I'm part of the community.
Oh, and thank you to all of you for being our Minutemen.
Yeah, I'll be honest. We would have gotten around to all of you at one point or another, but it was your dumb luck for saying, yeah, we'll all come on at once.
I can live with that.
Yeah. All right, and that is
the end. I am fine being someone's last resort. yeah. We'll be right back.
Thank you for listening to another episode of Atheist Nomads. You can find show notes and contact information at atheistnomads.com. Follow us on Twitter at Atheist Nomads, and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/atheistnomads. Please subscribe to the show in iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcatcher of choice, and while you're there, feel free to leave us a review. Theme music is courtesy of Sturdy Fred. Until next time, this has been the Atheist Nomads.